James, chapter 5. I want to focus my life on the score, pinpoint with laser precision the 13th verse of the 5th chapter of the Epistle of James. James, chapter 5, verse number 13. Then the Living Translation gives us the following. Are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. Repeat these words after me. Are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. Now I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor or neighbor, trouble. Now look across the room and find somebody you haven't seen and say, neighbor. Well, neighbor, I don't come to bother you. I don't come to stir your Kool-Aid. But I want to know if you know anything about trouble. Wonderful God, in the name of Jesus, help the preacher. Bless the people. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, ushers. You may be seated. Trouble. William Arthur Ward, I'm sorry, writes, some of these men only under the load of a heavy heart. Some eyes are opened only after the head is bowed. John Henry Jewett says, it is impossible to escape a multitude of trouble. It is possible to escape a multitude of trouble by living an insignificant life. The story is told that the only survivor of a wreck was thrown on an uninhabited island. In a few days, he managed to build himself a hut in which he placed the little that he had saved from the wreck. Daily, he prayed to God for deliverance, and anxiety scanned the horizon each day to hail any passing ships. One day, Terry, on return from a hunt for food, he was horrified to find his hut was in flames. All he had was gone up in smoke. He decided that God had forsaken him. Shortly, though, he saw a ship steaming to his rescue. We saw the smoke signal, said the captain, or we would have never known there was anybody here. Beloved, if you pray for rain, be prepared to deal with some mud. An African proverb says, smooth seas do not make skillful sailors. Beloved, the point of our exercise this morning is to deal with trouble. Somebody say trouble. To deal with trouble, suffering, and adversity that we encounter in our lives. In that trouble must not frighten. Somebody say you can't escape. And that trouble must not frighten the believer from living. Somebody say, I got to live. God is life and God gives life. You see, trouble is a part of our life's journey. I'm sorry to bust your bubble this morning, but trouble is an equal opportunity employer. Trouble has no respect of person. Trouble doesn't care about your age, height, weight, educational background, portfolio, land holdings, or acquisitions. Trouble enters everybody's life. At some point in your life, baby, you are going to experience trouble. adversity. No matter how happy some people may seem, they still have trouble. No matter how rich some people may be, they still have trouble. No matter how educated some people may have become, they still have trouble. No matter how handsome or attractive a person may be, they still have trouble. No matter how much charisma some may have, they still have trouble. And it doesn't matter how popular some people may be, even the Donald Trump himself has trouble to put up with. Beloved, I've discovered that trouble can accomplish what nothing else can. It can teach what nothing else can. It can provide what nothing else can. It can get one's attention like nothing else can. It can discipline an individual like nothing else can. It can minister to us like nothing else can. It can stay with us like nothing else can. Do I have anybody listening to me on the web? Do I have anybody up in this house that can identify with trouble? Oh, don't play with me. Do I have any worshipers in here that can testify to the enormity, to the weight of trouble? I got something in here. You got trouble at home. You got trouble at work. You got trouble with your car. You got trouble with your washing machine. You got trouble with your dryer. Trouble with your dishwasher. You got trouble with your students. You got trouble with your homework. You got trouble with your laptop. You got trouble with your shoes. You got trouble with your knee. You got trouble with your back. You got trouble with your toe. You got trouble with your head. You got trouble with your nose. You got trouble. Help me, Holy Ghost. Operate me. Our selected portion of the sacred text is housed in the book of James. Somebody say James. James is a unique book, beloved. In that some scholars even argue that James is a kind of Jewish book of wisdom, so somewhat like the book of Proverbs, but without as many one liners. James identifies himself as the author, but Terry and Susan. But does not provide the reader with any information about himself. At the center, the book of James takes issue with Christians who understand Paul's doctrine of, quote, the justification by faith apart from works of the law. They understood that to mean, this is what they understood it to mean, that it did not matter what you did as a Christian. As long as you believe. Our text, somebody say the text. Text of Peter James asked his listeners, are anyone among us suffering? James then suggests that those of us who are knowledgeable of trouble, suffering, and adversity, we should pray. Somebody say pray. James then asked if his listeners, if anyone of us is cheerful or happy, then we should sing songs of praise. James then asked his listeners if any one of us are sick. If so, we should call the leadership of the church together and pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. Somebody say, in the name of the Lord. It is obvious to me that James wants his listeners to understand this morning that trouble is not going anywhere. Now, perhaps for James, trouble, suffering, and adversity will be a normal part of one's life. And therefore, James wants to instruct his listeners on how to handle trouble. Now, look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Oh, neighbor. Do you know how to handle trouble? My job, Mrs. Ephraim, is to ask where God is in the text. My theological response, by the way, is that God does not want the believer to run from trouble. God wants the believer to respond to trouble, suffering, and adversity in a spiritual manner that exhibits the relationship that one has with God. Baby, I need you to stop running from trouble. When it just may be God that is calling you to trouble. You catch him exactly? So that God can further shape you for God's design. I wish I had some help in here. Y'all ready to get on the train? I'm ready to get on the train. Y'all ready? Now, first of all, a believer should respond to trouble by one, turning to God in prayer. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, it's praying time. Check it out. You see, my mother had two favorite verses. One of them is when James says that the prayers of the righteous availeth. That's the text she read. The one I read is powerful and effective. You see, James wants his listeners to understand that while trouble won't always, trouble isn't going on a vacation either. I wish I had some help in here. You see, James wants his listeners to turn to God in prayer when met by adversity. You see, this is what, check it out. Prayer is intended to give the believer the spiritual strength to endure with a godly spirit. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. You see, beloved, our prayers to God, Mr. Hubbard, are intended to remind us that God is the only one that we can trust in moments of experiencing difficulties. You see, poor child, when we encounter trouble, suffering, and adversity, we are to turn to God in prayer. You know, because trouble ain't going on a vacation, y'all. You see, that prayer reminds us that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. That prayer reminds us that they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. Those prayers remind us, poor child, that God never fails. Oh, those prayers remind us, Dr. Walker, that God is our shepherd, and therefore we shall not be in need. Therefore, when we are reminded of the awesomeness of God, we should in turn approach our moments of difficulty with a godly spirit, you see. Because if God be for us, I wish I had some help in here. Who can be against us? You see, beloved, I don't mind telling you. I don't mind telling you. Can I just expose myself? I don't mind telling you. I got a new attitude when it comes to trouble, because my God is more than able to give me what I need to survive. And do I have any believers up in here that can testify that your prayers have strengthened you and reminded you that God is able? Now if that is the case, you need to smile at your trouble instead of cussing your trouble out. You need to thank God for your trouble instead of sending trouble a nasty ground. Beloved, if we never had a problem, we would not know that God is a problem solver. And Dr. Wheeler, do I have anybody up in here that can testify that God is a problem solver? Do I got any problems up in here? I know 2 plus 2 is supposed to equal 4. Yeah. But some of us, we're on the minus side of life. And it's not adding up for us. But I'm here to tell you that God is an equalizer. Has God equalized something in your life? Yeah. You had your back up against the wall. They had you. But your God is an equalizer. I gotta go. Second. We need to turn to God in praise. Huh? Y'all with me? Turn to God. Turning to God in praise. The Greek word for cheerful means state of emotion. The Greek word For cheerful means state of emotion, not state of circumstance. You see, Mother Bill, for most of the time, our praise is contingent upon our state of circumstance. So when my pockets are full, health is in my body, food on the table, the kids are checking in on time, got air in the tires, I got a praise. Huh? But when I walk downstairs and I see a puddle of water, huh? When the refrigerator is all of a sudden defrosting itself on its own and I didn't tell it to. You see, James wanted his listeners to understand that when experiencing moments of difficulty, one should praise God as a state of emotion. I wish I had some help in here, not a state of circumstances. You see, beloved, we should praise God in our trouble, because as believers, we know that God is there. Somebody say, God is there. And because God is there, my emotions verify to my heart that I trust God. Now catch this. You see, our praise helps us to remember that God is there. Therefore, our praise to God is a state of factual emotion. You see, I don't believe one can have prayer without praise. You see, with prayer only, Sister Nelson, Evangelist Nelson, we would have the propensity to turn God into our errant person to help in human need only. You see, praise helps prayer to be balanced. You see, praise creates a state of emotion that lifts our spirits to say, God, you are worthy and deserving of all our worship and praise at all times. You see, when I look at the tremendous challenges ahead of me, my emotions tell me that God is able when my troubles and adversities say it is impossible. You see, our praise to God is seen in our happy spirit. I wish I had some business in here. You see, it is hard, beloved. It's hard to be sad and praise God at the same time. I wish I had some help in here. It's mighty difficult. It's mighty daunting to be sad and to praise God at the same time. You know, so that's why I adopt this posture. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know God watches me. So when we praise God, we don't have a choice but to cheer up and say, thank you, God. Thank you for being so good to me. And do I have anyone on the web, or do I have anybody in this house that will praise God for being a great God? Baby, don't allow your situation, don't allow your trouble, don't allow your suffering, don't allow your adversity to suffocate your praise. God deserves all. Somebody say, oh, check it out. If God is at work right now, if God is working right now, if God is working right now, then that means that God is working you through this to get you to that. And somebody ought to praise God right now, because God is working with you. God is working right now. God is not taking a nap. Don't worry about your situation, baby. God is working right now. Why don't you look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, God, neighbor, God is working right now. God is working to get you through that bankruptcy. God is working to get you through your healing. God is working to get you through your miracle. into the atmosphere and snatch down your miracle. I dare you right now to reach down and snap your deliverance. I dare you right now to say it's mine. Say it in the atmosphere, it's mine. It's my money. It's my
church. I heard him say, "Come, I stretch
was